Then we will start. Okay, we welcome everyone. My name is Olani Karemu. I'm here representing Synergy Nurses. You're welcome. Today we want to have like a quick interview with one of our Irish nurse talking about self-sponsorship. So for those that have been wanting to know more about the process of self-sponsorship, how you can self-sponsor yourself to Ireland as a nurse, this is a time for you, you know, to get all the details. But before I go ahead, I want to welcome our guest here, Kafilat Akombi. Nurse Kafilat Akombi is a registered Irish nurse here, and she actually came into the self-sponsorship pathway as well. So she'll be here to tell us you know, details about that. And if you have any questions, we will take questions afterwards. But before then, before, you know, I start asking all the basic questions about self-sponsorship, just to give us a bit background again. Again, like I said, this is Synergy International Nursing Network. My name is Olayin Karemu. I'm one of the co-founders of Synergy. And what we do basically is support international nurses and their, you know, dream, career dream of migrating or relocating to either Ireland or UK. I am based in Ireland. I've been in Ireland for the past 6 years. So, and this work has been ongoing for the last 5 years. So if you, maybe you just come across this video at a time and then you are wondering, what is this all about? So this is Synergy International Nursing Network. You can follow us on all our, you know, social media handles on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, where else? All the social media handles, so you can follow us for more details. If you have any inquiry, you can just send us an email, info@synergynurse.co.uk. Thank you very much. So let's go ahead now. First of all, where is Ireland? You know where Ireland is. Ireland is in the Europe, one of the European countries. So if you're interested in that, again, just send us your, you know, request and we'll follow, you know, we'll take you through the process. Thank you very much. So, welcome, Ms. Kafila.
Thank you.
Okay, so is the self-sponsorship, self-sponsor. First of all, if you want to relocate to Ireland, just know that you have to be a registered nurse, you know, in your home country. When I say registered, you have to be registered with the nursing board of your own country, and then every other process follows. So I'm going to leave it open now to Nurse Kafila to tell us more about that. First of all, when did you start the process? How long? Okay, now I'm not really good at interview, so let me start like this. First of all, just tell us about yourself and, you know, maybe what you were doing in Nigeria before you eventually make up your mind, you know, to come to Ireland.
Okay. My name is Kafilat Akombi. I'm a registered nurse, a registered midwife, and also a registered public health nurse in Nigeria. I came to Ireland in 2021, but then I used to work in Afe Babalola Multisystem Hospital in Ekiti. So when I applied to work in Ireland, I applied to NMBI. That was in 2019, but I didn't get my decision letter till 2020, April. So it took like a year, like more than a year to get my decision letter. So when I eventually got my decision letter from April to October, you know, that was during COVID time. That was in 2020. And you know how COVID was then. So I didn't get employed. Like I applied to different agencies, called nursing homes myself, like called hospitals myself, but you know, because of the COVID restrictions and all. No one wants to, like, you know, employ because of the restrictions. So I was just thinking, okay, I was waiting for my decision letter for almost a year. And now I received my decision letter. And, you know, it's just a 12 months validity. It has a 12 month validity.
Yeah.
After 12 months, haven't completed your exam or completed your adaptation, then that's it.
Yeah.
So April to October, I didn't see employer. And I was like, what will I do now? I can't find an employer. So someone told me, actually do self-sponsoring myself. The person that told me to doesn't really know about it because he actually doesn't know someone that has done it before. So it's just like a game of try it, let's see.
Mm.
So what I did, I went on the RCSI website and applied for the exam. That was ending of October.
Okay.
So I applied for the exam and then I had to pay. So with payments, because I have a friend in Ireland, she was here before me. So she helped me with the payments into the bank because you pay into the bank. I don't know how it is now. You pay into the bank, you don't do transfer or anything. So she helped with the payments and my application was received with RCSI and they gave me a date for the exam. So when I received date for the exam, that was for February 6th and 7th for 2021 for the exam. So when they gave me dates, I went to INIS website. That's the Irish immigration.ie website to see the requirements for visa application. So I was going through and I saw something like exam visa. Then I read about it that, okay, you can actually travel to Ireland for exam, but you need to have like the requirements are there. So I applied for the exam visa. And part of the requirements, you know, it's just like a short stay visa, like you're going for visits, like you want to visit someone or you're going for tourism. That is just what the exam visa is about. You need to have your proof of exam payments, like this exam you're going to do. You need to have the proof that you paid for the exam. Have a proof that, okay, they've confirmed that this exam has to be written in Ireland and nowhere else in the world. So assuming it's an exam that you can actually write in Nigeria or other countries, I don't know how the application would be, but you need to have that proof that you can only write it in Ireland. So what I did, I used my proof of payment for NABI and securing a theory test and exam test as my proof. Okay. And then they will see your commitment to your home country. Are you married? Do you have kids? Do you have a job?
Okay.
They want to see that you actually come back after your exam because the exam visa is just like a visit visa. It's just 3 months.
Yeah.
You can't stay more than that's for exam visa. So I applied for the exam visa. I was given a date to submit my documents in Abuja for the biometric and all.
Mm.
So, you know, it was during COVID. I went to Abuja to submit my documents. And when I got there, like I've prepared everything. The woman there told me, we are not taking short stay visa at the moment. Because then I told you there was restrictions and all, and they were only taking long stay. And even the long stays they were taking were just for nurses that have atypical working scheme that are coming to work, not coming to write exam, but they are nurses.
Okay.
Just all those long stay visas, we're not taking short stays at that time. So the woman told, no, we are not taking short stay. We are very sorry and all. She just told me to pack everything and leave. So I packed my documents on that day. I didn't know what to do. So I went to Embassy of Ireland in Abuja. I went to their office. So when I got there, I met the security, all these security people. You won't go inside. If you ever visited them before, they won't allow you to go inside. You have to talk to those people at the entrance.
Those security.
Yeah, so they are the ones that we call inside for you or tell you what to do. You don't go inside.
Okay.
So when I met this man outside, I explained everything to him and he was like, okay, just calm down. At the moment, we are not taking anything long stay. But because of your case, you are a nurse, you want to go and write exam to become a nurse. They might have everything. So he gave me an email address to the Abuja Visa Embassy email address. He told me to write my story, like everything that my situation, attach my evidence that I've booked my exam, everything, send it to them and wait for their response. So I went home that day. Yes, I was crying, but I went home. Like, what will I do? Just thinking about my life. I waited for 1 year for decision letter. I got decision letter. I did not see employer. Now I want to go myself. And this is happening. So I went back home. When I got home, I did as he told me, write my situation, catch everything and send to the embassy. So I sent it and they replied me the following day that I should come back and drop my application because they will take it and use that email as proof when I get there. I should show it to them that they sent me email to bring my documents back. I was asked, and then I went back, I think 3 or 4 days after I went to the embassy. And when I got there, the same woman told me, "We are sorry, we are not taking short stay." I just brought up my email. Brought it out. I gave it to her. And she was like, "Oh, okay. You're a nurse." I said, "Yes, I'm a nurse." "Oh, okay. All right." Then I submitted my my application and all.
I think I'll let you pause there to catch some breath. Okay. I know you have a lot to say. First of all, you know, when you started, it's good that we are doing this, because so many times when in the mentorship class, I would just say you can self-sponsor. I think I've done a video about the step and step like that, but people want real life experience. They want to see who has actually gone through this process. They want to see what challenges the person went through, how the person was able to overcome it and all that. So this is a beautiful experience that you are sharing. I'm going to go back to when you started your paperwork. Now, can you just highlight, I know people are, you know, watching this now, what were the documents, again, that you put together for your visa? Yeah.
Okay. So that one, I think, because I didn't finish my story, but let me just tell you.
Okay.
So my first visa application was denied. So they gave me reasons why they denied my visa application and they told me to work on them and appeal. So I went back again and gathered all the necessary documents and waited again. So part of the documents, number one, is the your theory exam, like that invitation letter they will send to you after booking your RCSI exam. That is after payments, that they are inviting you to come and write the exam. That is the number one proof that you are going to write exam. Number two is the NMBI decision letter. So you need to have your decision letter. They will know that, okay, NMBI has given you decision to come and write exam. That is number two. Then number three, it's your qualifications, your nursing and midwifery certificates, and then your BNSC, whether BNSC or diploma, your certificates. Then you need all those things. Then regarding the ties to home country, at first when I submitted my application, I didn't put that tie there. Like I didn't put it, I was married. I just said, marriage. So what I did about that, I submitted my original marriage certificate. Okay. My husband had to write a letter. My husband wrote a letter that I'm going for my I'm going for my exam, and I'll be coming back because he is at home. So I'm coming back to him because we just got married. And then I submitted pictures of me and my husband together, like our wedding, our introduction pictures, then random pictures too. I submitted it. Then another reason why they denied at first was sponsorship, because you need to have a sponsor. So if you're sponsoring, they look at your bank account. And then I don't know what it is now. Maybe if you go to irishimmigration.ie, they will state all the requirements there. But as at that time, you need to have a certain amount of money in your account because you are going for like 2 months or three months. So they want to know that you won't become a liability when you come to Ireland. They want to know that you have enough money to accommodation and sort yourself when you get. So that time I used a sponsor because he's a businessman and I used this company account at that time. So that time I can't remember how much he had in the account, but the account was like, it was a good account at that time. So another thing I didn't put is that when I used his account, I just stated that he's my sponsor and everything. I didn't show how we're related. Okay. I didn't show how, like, is he really ready to sponsor me? So I went back to collect a letter from him, like that's the letter from the sponsor, stating that he's fully aware I'm going to write exam and he's going to cover all the expenses. Okay. Everything, height and everything is going to cover for everything. And also another thing is he did an affidavit.
Okay.
So he went to the court and he did affidavit. You know, the way the affidavit person is my, your relationship with the person, and she's going for an exam, she's going to return back, she won't become a liability, just like an affidavit, and put the picture, passport.
Okay.
Then after that, you need to show...
Is it passport photograph or international passport?
You know, it's like a form for affidavit, then you just staple your passport photograph on the sponsor. Then another thing is that the sponsor needs to write a letter back for the bank statement explaining that we can withdraw from the account, not just a business account, but you can actually make withdrawal from that account.
Okay.
You need to write a letter and sign it at the bank. Then another thing is we took pictures together. Like, you need to have picture with your sponsor, like conversation, email. I printed out all the email conversations, WhatsApp conversations. We went to go and take pictures together, and like, you just need to prove to them that okay, sponsoring me is my mom, is my dad, is my brother, is my uncle.
Okay.
We know each other. He knows about me, and you know. So that was for the sponsor. And another thing they used, I remember all the documents I submitted, but as I'm remembering, I'll just be saying.
Okay, thank you so much. Now, like, I was typing just as you're saying. If you remember anything, you can just drop it. Probably not so good. Yeah, you can make a list of the document for us as we put in the chat. Thank you so much. So the other thing, now coming down, you have all your, you submitted it, and this time around it was granted, right? How long did it take before you get your visa?
Okay, it took me like 3 weeks. The first one I submitted, after 2 weeks, they called me. They gave me back my passport that I was denied.
Okay.
I went for the thing. Like, it took me 2 weeks to rebrand all the whole thing, gather all the necessary things. After 2 weeks, I submitted, and they gave me within 2 weeks. Yeah, it came out within 2 weeks.
The new one came out within 2 weeks. So
the new
once,
one came out
within 2 weeks. Yeah. So the gist is, if you have all your documents, everything ready, it shouldn't take more than, like, let me say, maximum 3 weeks, depending, you know, we don't know.
Depends. But what they put on their website is that 8 weeks, like maximum 8 weeks, that will be released. But mine came out within 2 weeks.
2 weeks. Okay, maybe thank you.
Closeness to my exam dates, because my exam was supposed to be in February and they released it in January. So.
Okay, so maybe they also consider the timing of the exam. So it's okay.
Yeah.
All right, so it's really important that you stress the time. If you already have an exam date, of course, you will have an exam date booked. Like, this is when I'm doing the exam, and you continue to emphasize on that on that time, so they can act, you know, promptly. All right, so now after you got the visa, what other things did you do? You were talking about immigration.
Okay, so when I got the visa, like, I didn't waste time, just booked my flight for the next 2 days. So when I came to Ireland, you know, when you're coming on exam visa, you are coming as a short stay, you are a visitor. You are not coming to stay long. You're just coming as a visitor.
Okay.
So when I came and I did my immigration thing, but during that time, we had to isolate for 2 weeks because it was during COVID. Mm. So when you enter Ireland at that time, you isolate for 2 weeks before you go out and do whatever things you want to do.
Yeah.
So when I got to I passed the immigration border, then I went into isolation immediately that same day for 2 weeks. And when I got out of isolation was actually the day I went to write my exam. So it was very close.
Okay.
My isolation finished today. My exam is tomorrow. My theory is tomorrow. So that was how it was. Then I went to write my exam. I passed. So when I passed, my employer wanted to apply for critical skills permit for me because I can't start working without my critical skills. Meanwhile, I'm supposed to go back after my exam because that is the rule of the visa. It's an exam visa. Once you finish your exam, you have to go back. Then when you get employer, then you have to come back. So my employer said they are going to apply for critical skills for me.
Okay.
They applied.
Okay, sorry, I'm going to pause you there because that's one of the questions. So, do you need an employer before you can get the visa? Even
No.
if you are self-sponsoring.
No.
Okay,
I
because
got I had an interview the day they released my visa. That was the day I had an interview with an employer. So they already released my visa, and then I also got a job. So
okay,
when I travel,
so you
yes.
don't need, that's just to clarify because somebody has been coming back to me, you don't need an employer to apply for an exam visa for, you
You
know,
don't.
your RCSI. You don't need. Okay, good.
You don't.
Thank you.
You don't need an employer. I already got my visa before I got a job, so that you
Okay.
don't
Okay.
need. They put application for my critical skills permit, and you know that time it took about 2 months for them to review my documents. So after that 2 months, they go back to me that they won't be releasing my critical skills because I came in as a visitor and I don't have a typical working scheme. So they won't give me my exam, my critical skills. Like I'm not, according to them, I am not entitled to it.
Okay.
So what they did at that time, my employer, they didn't want me to go back because they were like, why would you go back in COVID, during this COVID crisis? You want to go back and then you will not come back. So they tried their best. They tried their best to make me stay during that time, but it wasn't an easy one. It was very tough, even for me, for just to get me stay so that I don't go back and then to release my critical skills permit. Eventually, they released it and I started working, but it wasn't an easy one. Like like the employer has to look for solicitors, get information, get documents, try to give them reasons why I shouldn't go back, why I should stay back. And another thing, at that time, I could remember I saw that Nigeria, like they canceled their traveling at that time. So no flight was able to enter Nigeria. At that time, that I was supposed to go back. No flight was able to enter. So
Okay.
I used that as proof that I
Another
can't go back
excuse.
because
Okay.
that I can't go back because of the flights
And
restrictions in
COVID.
Nigeria. Yeah, and COVID and everything.
Okay. So if I get it clearly, and just for people listening, usually because you're coming in for an exam, they expect that you should go back afterwards. But again, I think it all depends on the employer that you eventually get. So the advice would be, even if you are self-sponsoring, you still be on the lookout, you know, still keep applying. I think so most employers, once they realize that you are self-sponsoring, if they know that you already paid for your exam, most employers will be eager to give you a job offer. And most of them will, I'm still coming back to that, may reimburse you your exam fee, you know, after you, if you pass, some of them may reimburse. So the idea is, even though you are self-sponsoring, just still keep, you know, applying to get a job offer, and then the employer will be the one to apply for your critical work permit or AWS, everything that will make you stay. I think they can also, first of all, apply for the AWS as soon as you come in as well. So once you are in the country, you know, it might be easier. It will be easier to get an employer if you are in the country. It's easier. You know, you are in the country. I know you are preparing for an exam or you have written an exam. So quickly, you know, the process can, you know, can just go ahead till you get a critical work permit. And for those that don't know what critical work permit is a type of visa that's usually for eligible occupations, and nursing is part of it, like occupations that are eligible for job offer and all that for visa. So you are given that, and that's the duration for like 2 years stay. Automatically, you can stay for 2 years, and then you can renew that. You get your permanent residency. So that's about critical work permit. Now, if you have any question, you can drop it. I don't know if it's from me. My network is checking. You can drop it in the chat box. But Noskafila, still going ahead now. You got your visa. After you got your critical work permit, and then when did you start the job?
Okay, when I actually started immediately, I got my critical skills. Like the following day, they released my critical skills. That was when I started working, because my employer too, they've been waiting for the critical skills, because I was not able to start employment. Even though I got in offer since January, I didn't start till May.
So what were you doing between February and May?
Between February and May, praying and exploring Ireland.
That was a good time anyway. So, and you were not able to walk even as a carer?
No,
because you don't have a work.
Down as a carer and let me start, like, just to know the system, be familiar with the system. And they told me, no, we can't. You need to have your critical skills. You need to get your permission. So,
you have to have a right to walk, a paper to walk. Before you can walk. So again, it's possible for you to come in on an exam visa for the RCSI OSCE. We're still going to talk briefly about, you know, the exam. For those that are interested, if you are coming in, you need some extra tutorials preparation for your exam so that you can pass. It doesn't make sense paying that huge amount of money, crossing all the seven seas, and then come over here and don't pass. So if you are interested, at Synergy, we offer RCSI tutorials, both the CBT and the OSCE. You can start when you're from Nigeria, you can start from your own country. And then when you come over here, we have the one-day mock preparation that is also included in the package. So if you're interested, you can subscribe to that. So it's everything, all the stations taking you through, and then you have a live practical when you come into the country. For the exam, it's very important to prepare so you don't fail. Now let's talk about the most important question, is about the money. People are very particular about how much it costs to self-sponsor. So do you mind to share?
Okay. The thing is, I can just give a rough estimate. I can't remember everything. But the first thing is to make sure you have your exam money. I think it's 2008 for self-sponsoring. 2,800 if you're self-sponsor. So once you have your 2,800 paid, then you have your invitation for exam. That one is sorted. Then another thing will be just a visa application fee. And the visa application fee, just to book an appointment for Nigeria, I paid, I think, around 23,000 to book an appointment. And then I paid around 56. I can't remember whether it was 56, but it was around 50-something for my visa application at the visa center in Abuja. Then if you're not living in Abuja, you want to consider wherever you're traveling from, you want to consider the cost of traveling, because the first time I went, I actually went by bus. So you need to consider that. The second time I went with flight because it was too close and I had to get there immediately. So just what consider accommodation.
Can you apply in Lagos, the embassy in Lagos?
Okay, you can actually apply. I can't remember what happened at that time that I didn't go to Lagos. I think that time I read they are not taking applications in Lagos, yes. Okay. Because of COVID. But now that would have changed by now. Okay. That was why I went there for the submission. And also because of my situation, I have to go to Abuja. Yeah. So just consider the cost for traveling and accommodation. Then once you get your visa, you book your flight tickets. So it depends on where your exam is. If you are not too close to your exam period, then it's very good for you because you get a good ticket for your flight. But if it's too close, then you might be paying more for your flight tickets. At that time, I think I paid around 350,000 for my flight tickets at that time. But I don't know how much it will be now.
I think when I got to COVID, it was so expensive during COVID. Yeah. It was
COVID. And I think when I got to Ireland, I was so lucky. So you have a friend here. So I stayed with my friend for the period of my isolation, 2 weeks. So I was my friend. I didn't spend anything. But if you don't have anybody you're coming to stay with, then you need to, you know, that's part of your, you need to have a proof that you have accommodation booked to stay. When I did my own application, I actually booked a short hostel. I booked a hostel for 2 weeks for my exam. Yeah, I could remember. I submitted it as part of my visa application. But the thing is, before that time, self, the hostel even cancelled my reservation, although my visa already came out. They cancelled it themselves because of COVID. They don't want people to come from overseas today. So I was actually still lucky I had to stay with my friend. So if they're coming, you need to get accommodation booked. Then you need to sort out where you will stay for your period of exam until when you finish your exam. So if you have an employer, I don't know how it is, if employer are fighting for people to stay now at the moment, I don't know. There's no COVID at the moment, but I don't know how it is now. So employer might give you accommodation. They gave me accommodation. After I passed my exam, they gave me accommodation till that, from that February till May that I started working, my employer gave accommodation. So it still depends on the employer. So okay, if you are going back, so you just have to book accommodation for the period you use. Once you pass the exam, then you go back. But then there are some circumstances. For example, you might, I'm not saying you will not pass your exam at once, but it happens. You might have to stay back for maybe one station or two stations. Then you need to like book another accommodation for that. So I think that's basically what I spent money on. I can't remember any other thing I spent money on.
Okay, so for like the AWIs, was the employer that paid for you, and you know, your critical skill was the employer. And did the employer refund the RCSI fee?
Yes. So they refunded the 2008 RCSI did back to me. And they also gave me back my flight money.
Wow. Yeah, okay.
Flight money. They gave me back my 2008 for the exam.
That's relieving anyways. And I think that's what operates. So for those that are interested, if you let the employer know, if you are sending email for application, you can tell them that you are self-sponsoring, you have booked your exam, you just need a job offer to make your visa process. So, and then usually they will refund the fee either way. And also the flight fee. So yeah, there's a question there, just paying for RCSI test brightest one chance for getting an employer. I think that's just what I've just said now. So because like I said, since COVID, most of the employers or recruiters are struggling with funding. So, they just want people are already available in the country that they don't have to spend so much money on. But either way, they are still recruiting. So if an employer knows that, this person has already paid, I think it also will increase your chances of getting a job offer, which you need for your visa. Not for the visa to come in, but for your critical work permit. That's the most important thing. The other question is about midwives. Midwives to sponsor. Do you have an idea about this so I can answer? So I know that midwifery, they don't do the RCSI OSCE. So for you to do your, because I'm also a midwife, I actually applied for my midwifery registration too with NABIA, and I got a decision letter. So my decision letter came after I was already, I was already here. I got the general decision letter. And I think 3 months after, I got the midwifery decision letter because I applied together. So again, a general nurse, a midwife, public health nurse, you can do all your application at once together, and you only pay the same amount of money. That's 145 for your registration, and the 350 that you pay is still be the same. If you submit all your documents within 7 days, apart, everything together. So for midwifery, if you have a decision letter, usually you need an employer, because midwifery, they are only doing adaptation for now and not RCSI. So there's no RCSI pathway, like the OSCE pathway for midwifery as at now. A recent, they started the RCSI pathway for the psychiatry nurses. I think that was late last year, 2022. So if a psychiatry nurse, you can also self-sponsor yourself and pay for your RCSI exam, and then you get an employer. But for the midwifery, usually it's adaptation. Adaptation means that you need to have an employer that will take you in for 6 weeks in your adaptation program. So you cannot sponsor or for, but things change. Like I said, psychiatry nursing only started late last year. So there could be a change, but I know that for sure. For public health nursing, the same thing applies. You need an employer for adaptation. So public health nursing as well is adaptation, because I also did the same. So that's about that. Now, talking about, somebody said is the amount you mentioned in euros or pounds. Yes, in euro. So Ireland spend euro. The currency in Ireland is euro. 2,800 for the RCSI exams. You know, that's the most important thing that you need. Once that is paid, others will be in your own home country currency, like your flights. You have to figure that out. The visa application in the embassy, you have to figure that out from your country. So, but I know that visa generally for single entry, it's between 60 to 100 euros. So depending on the exchange rates in your country. So thank you so much, Naskafi.
There's a message from her.
Okay, thank you for this message. Please, what if I have money to sponsor myself? Do I still need to have a sponsor? Okay, so do you want to explain that? There's a difference between you self-sponsoring. Now you are saying that you are self-sponsoring me, that you want to pay for your exam. But for your visa, before you can get a visa, you need a sponsor. You need a sponsor that will say that every other thing you will do, you know. But if you have the account, I think if you have money in your own account, you can sponsor yourself.
Yes.
If you have all the money you need for your accommodation, for your feeding, for the whole of the 2 or 3 months, if you have it in your account, then you can sponsor, you can be your own sponsor. You just say, well, I'm my sponsor. But remember, it is important that you know the way this bank statement is, there shouldn't be any chunk money put into the account. They are very clever, they are psychologists. So
yeah.
You cannot just borrow money for somebody, maybe 500,000 and drop it today. The next one, you are dropping 1 million. They will know that this is an intentional thing and that alone will disqualify you. You know, so we have to be very careful about that. If you don't have that money, you have been saving for years in your account, it's better you get a sponsor. I hope that explains. Well, okay.
As part of your documents for your visa application is also your employer. So if you're applying from Nigeria for an exam visa, you need to be working. You need to have an employer, you need to have somewhere you're working. So you need a letter from them, whether the chief medical director or whoever is the owner of the place. You need a letter from that person stating that you're working with them, since when you've started working with them, and that you are going to write exam and you're coming back to them. Stamped, and it must carry the organization, on the letterhead. So you need that. Then you also need your ID card. So if you're working in a hospital, wherever you're working in Nigeria, you are going to have a staff ID. So you need to make photocopies of your staff ID, attach it with your application, and then you need to have your pay slip. I think your last 3 months recent pay slips, you need to put it with your application. I just remember that one. I said I should say it.
Okay. That's very important. So I'm just going to recap what Nastafi said there. But apart from all the documents that has been mentioned before, you need a letter from your current employer where you are working, or in your own country, that you are working there and you're only going for an exam. So remember, we are talking about self-sponsorship. And when you talk about self-sponsorship, that means you're coming through the exam pathway to Ireland for the RCSI, CBT, and OSCE. So just to recap again, the RCSI exam is in two parts. You have the theory part and the practical part. So, and they are done, I think now it's just a day apart. Before it used to be a week apart, but now it's just the second day. Once you do the theory, then you do the OSCE the second day. So you have to pass the theory before you can be given invitation for the practical. But you have opportunity to receipt. So I think only, is it twice? Twice receipt if you fail any of the stations for the practical. Now, so you also need a current staff ID card, apart from a letter from your employer in your home country. Remember, this is exam. So we know that You're coming here to do exam. And the most important thing is that you want to get your thing. That's what you need. So if you're coming in for the exam, you need the proof to show that you're going back to your home country, you know, ending, you're getting your PIN and all that. So you need that, your payslips. I think the last 3 months, payslip, you know, you also need to prove to show that. The exam is only done in Ireland, okay? And RCSI is Royal College Southern in Ireland. So the exam is only done in Ireland, all right? So you can't do it. Even the CBT had to be, the physical CBT had to be done in Ireland. Somebody's asking about the rough estimate. So we have mentioned, again, I've done a video before about this, and I'll send in a document as well that states all this step by step. So roughly, with the AWS, in case you will be the one to get your, you know, pay for your AWS or every other thing, roughly 4,000 for the exams. That is my own estimation. Things could, you know, change. Remember, the flight tickets can change, you know, the visa application can change. So, but roughly 4,000 euros. So you can get the estimates in your, you know, depending on the exchange rates. Now, the other question is, can Synergy make payment? So like she rightly said, you have to make the payment, you know, it's in the bank. Like if you have to be through bank account, pay into Ireland, you know, a euro account, okay? So usually you need somebody that is in Ireland. So we also offer assistance as well with international payments. So that should not be a problem. Or if you have a friend, a relative that is in Ireland as well, you just have to pay the equivalent naira and then they do all the conversion. And that is that. So I don't know if we left anything out. So what is the cost of the end? Okay, OSCE training at Synergy. So for Synergy, OSCE, RCSI, both CBT and OSCE, we are doing it 150 euros. That is the amount. But for Nigerian, there's a special package for Nigerians. It's 50,000 flat rate. So about 150 euros for every other country. That includes the CBT and the OSCE as well, and mock. So you have a physical mock. So imagine you have up to more than 4,000 or 6,000 CBT questions for parties. And then you have your own personal tutor for your RCSI, you know, for the OSCEs. Then you have one day mock, all that's included. So that's a very easy, that's a giveaway price. But there are so many communities as well, you know, that you can get trainings if you want, free. That's about that. Thank you again. Let me come back to Nostafi for your time. So we'll be talking about sponsorship to Ireland as a nurse. If you're interested, you can send us an email, info@synergynurse.co.uk. Thank you very much. Do you have a last, do you want to encourage our nurses? It's to be Irish nurses, just some word of motivation and encouragement. Thank you.
Okay, so what I'll just say is don't give up. Even if you haven't found an employer now, still don't give up. But the thing is, you need to make moves too. You need to like know what you want for yourself. You can't just be waiting for an employer for a year and your decision letter is going to expire and not do anything because you know what you did to get that your decision letter. So just ask questions. That is very important. Ask questions because you don't know everything. Just check, ask people that have gone through it, ask questions, just don't just stay quiet. That is it. And don't give up and pray. It definitely happened. You will come here, you will pass your exam, you get your PIN, you will start working as nurse. You become
an Irish nurse.
An Irish nurse.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you so much. We are going to how long should the money? The question people is how much should the money in your sponsor account stay? I would say to you, get your PIN. I'll say to you, you get your PIN because, yeah, they can always go back and check. You know, immigrations are very crazy. So yeah. You can always go back and check records. So till you get your PIN, once you get your PIN.
If you want to get your visa approved, for exam, you need to work on your bank statement, your sponsor's bank statement. It's very important. Like, I know some people that have been denied the exam visa because of the bank statement. So you need to make sure, even if you are sponsoring yourself, you don't just go and bring money and put money in their account. That money has to be there for a long time. And they should see the inflow and outflow. If you have any big money entering your account, you should be able to explain what the money is for. Did you sell any property? Did someone give? You need to explain and attach that proof for your visa. So it was possible for me because the person I used is a business. I told you it's a business account. The money has been entering and going in and it's always there. So it's very important. If you have a good bank statement, then I think your visa will be granted.
Okay. Thank you so much. We'll let you go now. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Okay. Thank you so much again. We'll be talking about self-sponsorship to Ireland as a nurse. And that's, we had our guest, Nurse Kafi, has told us so many things about what you need to self-sponsor yourself to Ireland. If you still have any other questions, please feel free to ask. For all the nurses in the mentorship, we'll just let us know if you are deciding to self-sponsor, then we can, you know, guide you through it. Otherwise, you know, you can continue to look for the employer. Hopefully you get a job offer and then you can start the process. Thank you very much. You are supposed to, not just the limits, it's the starting point. And before you know it, boom, you're an Irish nurse. All right. So thank you very much. If you still have any other questions, you can drop it in the comment section. You can drop it in the group chat, and then we'll take it from there. Lovely to meet you all. Thank you. Have a lovely evening.